Now, let me just mention that this is a meeting in a series of actually meetings we had. We started already with a European Awareness Day on primary immunodeficiency in the year 2002. Then we had the STORE workshop on primary immunodeficiency actually in the year 2004, where some of you already were present and pushed the whole PID initiative here in the European Parliament. Then we had actually a PID consensus conference in Langen that was in 2006, which is available on the net and as a book and a CD if you want to know about this. Then we had the European Parliament lunch debate on primary immunodeficiency on rare plasma disorders. Then you mentioned already the activity of MEP Dr. Katsimarkakis. And more recently, actually, Dr. Katsimarkakis had another activity that was only 4 weeks ago. So it's very timely that we have all this now since there's a new commissioner. This is another activity on the expert recommendations for better management of primary immunodeficiency. And the one who initiated it and helped a lot with that is Stephen Bridge, who's amongst us. So you see, this now finally is a very important activity why we meet here. This is driving diagnosis for optimal care. And that's why we are here. And why is diagnosis so important in this context? You heard about it already. We are dealing with a rare disease. Primary immunodeficiencies belong to the rare disease, and there is some attention during the last time on rare diseases. But particularly, the primary deficiency is widely underdiagnosed, and it belongs to a disease which has severe consequences if it is not diagnosed and if it's not timely diagnosed. So we have therapy, we have a number of strategies available to avoid the severe consequences which are there for individuals. We all know that from the child of Vicky and Fred Modell, from Jeffrey. We know it from the family who are affected, and you all know it from the society and the social burden, which is connected, of course, with this. And I like to make a few remarks on primary immunodeficiencies. It is a genetic condition which we now count about 160, sometimes already 250. So it's a huge number of different specific genetic conditions. And it's often overlooked. Why it's overlooked? Because it's just infections, it's maybe some diarrhea, it's not really a normal growth of some baby, it may be a sepsis, it may be a pneumonia, and therefore it's just seen as a normal complication during the course of the growth or development of some normal human individual. And the main point in not detecting this is that it's rare, and that people are not really trained, neither in the professional area nor in the lay area, in this area to recognize a disease. So there's really a deficit in knowledge, in training, in immunology, particularly in immunodeficiency. And that's something we really have to address here today. Now what about the diagnosis and the frequency of immunodeficiency? There's a wide range. The current level suggests, for instance, in Germany, that we talk about 1 in 10,000, 1 in 8,000. It ranges for the far more advanced frequency we see in Scandinavia, where they have obviously much better epidemiology and talk about 1 in 250 or 1 in 500. So it may be much more frequent than we think. It is certainly true that we only diagnose about 70 to 90% of the patients who really suffer from this disease. Now, coming to the treatment modalities for kids and particularly babies, it's very critical to make the diagnosis earlier and early enough. Otherwise, they die from infectious complications. And for sure, we have bone marrow transplantations. And we also have already a number of genetic modalities available, still experimental, where we can treat and even cure patients nowadays. And last not least, for the majority of patients, we have available the immunoglobulins, which we can apply to these patients who suffer from antibody deficiency. And we have a number of other supportive modalities like antibiotics, like prophylaxis, like vaccines, which we all could use really to help these patients to really lead a normal life. Just a few numbers which stem from a careful analysis you did in the US. Fred, it showed that basically the average cost of a patient, if it's not diagnosed, is annually about €75,000. And if we really would treat a patient diagnosed, we run about €16,000 annually. So that shows you the difference. And then these patients are also, or these, then not anymore that patients, they could lead a normal life, could be available for the workforce, for the market, and really could be very productive. So that's why we come together to really talk about early diagnosis. I think we will hear about it from different stakeholders, particularly from also from Lennart Hammarström, and also the models of the activities we see already in the US, so that screening early might be really something we aim to. We'll be discussing that at the end. And the other important point, I think, is certainly that we train people and get something. I also address my UEMS people and also the European colleagues, that we have a subspecialization in immunology. That's the only way, really, to get people involved, to get the knowledge there. What I think is also timely, what I just learned, that you open up in September in Ireland and Dublin a center, a JMF center. I hope the new commissioner may see that as an incentive coming from his own country to get some awareness to primary immunodeficiency. I think I conclude there that we have enough time for discussion, and like to invite José Drapwell to deliver her speech here from the patient's perspective.